Hey folks, welcome to No Tech Talk with Barb, and that's K-N-O-W, tips, advice, and consulting from your business's IT department. I'm your host, Barb Paluskowicz, and for those of you taking notes, Paluskowicz is spelled the exact way it sounds, Paluskowicz. Trust and verify on our website, cdntechnologies.com. What I want to share with you today is how to protect your business from losing huge sums of money because of a fake email. Because here's the shocking truth about bank fraud on business accounts. Your company's business bank account does not employ the same protections as your personal bank account. So if someone social engineers your payment team to transfer money out of your business account, the bank is not responsible for getting your money back. Many people think the CDIC protects them from fraud, but it doesn't. It protects you from bank insolvency, not fraud. And even though it's the bank systems, we're held accountable. And it's the worst because we all do banking online. And big or small, you know what? Thieves, they want it all, your money and your information. And they're successfully doing so with business email compromise. And other names for this are fake CEO email scams, whaling, CEO fraud, president fraud, or payment reduction fraud. And how these scams work is that they target a company's payment team by impersonating a contractor, supplier, or creditor, or even someone within the senior management of your company. The email address will appear to closely match and look like a legitimate email address. Or you know what? Sometimes people don't even know that their emails have been hacked. The payment team receives instructions to pay an invoice, and they think it's real. And unfortunately, they act on it, resulting in the transfer of funds. It's big business. It's expecting to hit like $6 trillion in damages by 2021, which is like 4 months away. So I want you to know how to defend yourself against business email compromise. So please listen carefully. I have a little bit of a list. And then I have someone very educated joining us to shed some light as well. So the first thing that you should do is cancel your debit cards. They are the number one ways bank accounts get compromised. Another thing is to have a dedicated PC or tablet for online banking. And don't use that PC for any other website or email or social media, like nothing. And then when you get emails that are instructing you to pay, make sure they're from the right person. Like really have a look at that email address, because you know what? Sometimes an L can look like a number one. Like really pay attention. And you want to verify the payment requests and changes to an account, like when they ask you to update the wire transfer information. You know what? Reach out to the contact. You know what? Phone them. Go old school. Call them. You know, enable two-factor authentication for when you're going to be doing transfer. And you want to make sure that you look out for unusual changes in a business practice. For example, if you're getting requests from someone who is normally not involved in the payment process, you know what? That's a little bit weird sometimes. So reach out to them. Another thing that you want to do, and like these are all simple things that you can do, and they don't cost money, but sign up for email alerts from your bank whenever there's a withdrawal over, I don't know, $100 or $1,000, whatever you feel comfortable with. If you're going to do a wire transfer, it requires signatures. And you know what? Have money spread out in multiple accounts to minimize the risk. And the last thing that you want to do, and it's really important, and that is carry insurance. So joining us today is Greg Markell, President and CEO of Ridge Canada Cyber Solutions. Ridge Canada is focused on providing insurance solutions for clients' cyber and privacy needs. And Greg is very well versed on the topic and of cyber and privacy liability for public and private organizations. So thank you, Greg, for joining us on No Tech Talk today. How's it going? Introduce yourself to everybody out there.
Well, thank you for having me, and great to be with everyone. Yeah, I'm Greg Markell. Barb, what an intro. When it comes to preventative measures, I mean, that is the music to an underwriter, an insurance underwriter's ears when it comes to preventing social engineering fraud. A little bit about myself. I am the president and CEO of Ridge Canada Cyber Solutions. We are what's called a managing general agent, which is, in insurance talk, a wholesale market. We underwrite on behalf of different insurance companies at right now, mainly Lloyd's of London. So we actually have the pen, which means that we underwrite business for Canadian, we underwrite Canadian companies. All we do is cyber and privacy insurance, and that extends into the social engineering fraud world. So we're focused on small, medium enterprise. We're just launching a large enterprise wording, which will be which is available to brokers today. But we only deal with licensed insurance brokers. So brokers bearing us risks, we look at it, we underwrite it, and we assign pricing and set the contracts. And that, in a nutshell, is who we are. Is what we do. Who we are is the Ridge in Ridge Canada is actually named after our namesake is Governor Tom Ridge, who was the governor of Pennsylvania through the 90s. And in 2001, when the towers came down, George Bush Jr. actually tapped Governor Ridge on the shoulders and asked him to consolidate all of the United States intelligence agencies, and the Department of Homeland Security was born. So Tom led and at one point had over 600,000 different intelligence officers reporting into him, but he was the first Secretary of Homeland Security. And wonderful, wonderful man. I would be remiss if I didn't say happy belated birthday to him, because that was yesterday. He turned 75. So happy birthday, Governor Ridge.
Do you know what Tom Ridge and I have in common?
What's that?
Our birthdays.
Ah, happy belated, Barb.
So that means we're both Virgos. So about social engineering and way to like segue into that. I'm just going to get right into it. An employee is tricked into turning over millions of dollars, what do you need to have in place so you're covered?
So it's a great question. Some of those things that you alluded to and on the intro are actually really the questions that we ask to help underwrite these things. So from a process and controls standpoint, we ask three questions, and you know there are a number of there's ways to get more limits, but from a cyber and privacy standpoint, typically the way the market has gone is we're throwing in it, and it is literally throwing in coverage up to, you know, smaller limits or sublimits of coverage. But we ask three questions, and they're really controls based. And just like you alluded to, Barb, is the three questions that we ask are actually free risk control measures that the bank provides. So you can actually tackle these things off with a single phone call to your finance, to your bank. So the first one is dual signatures or dual authorizations on amounts over a certain amount. So having two people within the organization, just a second set of eyes before anything goes out. That's step number one. So before we ask the number that we put out and draw, and keep in mind, like we are focused on commercial organizations, so less so personal. You know, if my better half had to look at amounts over $10,000, I might never talk to her. but the $10,000 mark is actually that sort of line in the sand that we draw from a corporate standpoint. So, but that's a conversation internally that your business should have from a risk mitigation standpoint, is what is that number? What makes sense to us, and what's not going to slow down our business? So our application, we ask $10,000. So do two people have line of sight on amounts going outside of the business that are over $10,000? The second is exactly what you said, the old fashioned way of calling people. It's a lost art, I think, but actually callback provisions. Major preventative measure. So if someone's asking to change banking information, then call back the number that you have on file. Call that supplier, call that vendor, call your trusted person on the other side. If they're not there, wait, don't transfer it out. You know, email is, it's faceless, right? So it's very easy to just fall into that trap and transfer money out without speaking to someone about why. Why am I, was there a change on your end? What's happening? Should we be, is there some sort of concern that we should be worried about? But you don't find that out by emailing someone back. Call them. So that those callback provisions and a lot of policies in insurance, it's actually a good point to make, is you should be looking at your actual insurance contract language, because some of them have what's called conditions precedent language, which means thou shalt do this. And if that is one of those things that's in your wording, then, you know, it's something to communicate to your finance department and to anyone that's handling money on behalf of your organization. But calling them back, very basic, very easy. It takes some time, but it's a safeguarding measure that can save you tons of headaches. The last one that we ask about, and this is, so these three questions, what we found is they eliminate probably between 80 and 85% of these sort of incidents. But the last question that we ask is, if you're doing online banking, EFTs, wires, everything else, do you have multi-factor authentication to log into your banking, to your online banking? And what that means is that could be your thumbprint, that could be your face, you know, with cell phones and everything now, that could even just be a text message that you authorize. So gone are the days, you know, multi-factor authentication. We used to get a lot of pushback from organizations saying, especially small businesses in Canada, like, I don't need this. This is crazy. What are we doing? This is going to slow me down so much. And now I think everybody's coming around to the fact that, you know, this is a very easy preventative measure. You don't leave your house without your cell phone. So, you know, if that, it's the same thing as starting your car, right? So, and it's a bit of a misnomer because you can actually start your car with your cell phone now, but but that's those. So those are the three questions that we ask.
The thing is with banking, because when we do our security assessments and we go through all of this, and when we do our security awareness training, the thing with banks though, and this is a pet peeve of mine for Canadian banks, is that to enable two-factor authentication on your bank account, you have to have a business bank account and it you have to upgrade it. So you have to pay increased monthly fees, and there's no ways around it. And I know that some companies that are smaller, so you know, if you only have like 5-10 employees type of thing, and you're growing, when you grow, you really have to watch the numbers, watch the cash flow and things like that, so that you can stay afloat sometimes. And essentially, a bank will want you to pay, I don't know, I'm trying to remember how much it was. I think it was $90, like, you know what? And the $90, you know, at times 12. And my customer was just like, Barb, do I really need to pay this? Like, you know, this is ridiculous. I can get two-factor for free, like, you know what, like everywhere else, but the bank is now charging. I'm just like, yeah, it's one of those things. They kind of have a monopoly on it. So yes, you know what, I recommend doing the two-factor, and then all of these other things. Like it is a little bit of a sore point, because Canadian bank accounts make you pay for two-factor authentication.
They do. However, I would just say that some of the very coolest technological developments that we're seeing is coming out on bank funding as well. Like up for my two-factor authentication, it does a retinal scan from my cell phone. like that is next level. That's like the George Jetson banking. It's very cool. And so for $90, yeah, it is $90 a month. That's or whatever the number is. I agree. It is a little bit much, but I think what we need to keep in mind as Canadian business owners as well is the fact that we have one of the most stable banking systems in the entire world. They're investing into Canadian technology development and they're very secure. Like the banks are some of the most secure institutions in this world. They have hundreds of millions of dollars that they deploy. And you look to our neighbors in the South and, you know, when we're underwriting things and we're underwriting some of these institutions and large businesses and mid-level businesses, as well as small businesses, you know, one of those things that always comes up, and it doesn't come up as much as it used to, but we used to hear all the time, you know what, we're fine, we're secure, we're good. The reality is you're not. Anyone that tells you that they're 100% certain that your business is secure, unfortunately, they might be lying to themselves because there is no silver bullet when it comes to security. But we do model a lot of businesses model themselves after the bank's securities and you know, layered security, all of these great things. And these are the wonderful part about it is some of these things. And I'm sorry for going off on a tangent, but some of these things are Canadian developed, and it's wonderful to see Canadian business being that you know, prevalent on a global stage. The fact that I need to scan my eyes before that's the second layer of security before my wires go out. That's fantastic. Like as soon as my bank actually told me, they're like, this is what you have to do. I was like, no problem. That's amazing.
I think those security measures are great. And I think that, I don't know if you've ever seen that meme where it says like, you know what, the budget for cybersecurity solutions before a breach or an attack, and you see pennies, like, you know, the guy like pushing but after it happens, it's like Scrooge McDuck opening the vault, like I'll do anything to like get it back, and they throw money at it. So with that in mind, what does a cyber policy cover? And what does like a fidelity policy cover? Because I know that they have that whole three D dishonesty, disgruntled, and something else. So, anyways, there's two different types of policies that a business can get, and one covers data, and one covers essentially money and accidents and things like that. And you know what? If you fall victim, if your business, even with all of these two-factor, you know, a phone call, like everything, you know, you do all these things to mitigate it, but essentially, like you said, there's not a silver bullet. You're 99% safe, but that one time, it's like unprotected sex. Like, you know, that one time.
Yeah. It's a great analogy. yeah, and you hit the nail on the head. And I will admit that this is something that is going on from a debate perspective within the entire insurance industry, is where does this type of loss belong? But exactly to your point, Barb, there are two policies where social engineering can potentially be picked up. And one is the cyber and privacy liability. That really has sort of been forced. Market forces have pushed it to actually pick these things up, because a lot of the times these wires and things are being done digitally. So there's a little bit of a misnomer on that basis that, you know, I've got cyber coverage. So my social engineering coverage is also included. Not necessarily the case. The difference between a fidelity policy and a cyber policy is data and dollars. Exactly like you said, a cyber policy was designed to cover loss of data, not loss of money, securities, bullion, goods, all of those things. The challenge is market forces have sort of pushed the cyber policies and the underwriting into that coverage. Now, there are a couple of things that you need to know. The fidelity policies previously were not picking up that type of loss. And the reason was it was a voluntary parting of goods. And so the contract language, the fidelity policies, keep in mind, a lot of these policies have not been updated since 1997. So they're putting patchwork in terms of addendums onto these contracts. And that was the reason originally why it was tough to cover these types of losses. So now what we've seen in the Canadian marketplace, there's precedent, legal precedent, where certain things are not picked up. So the voluntary parting of money or goods is really, you need to have that social engineering fraud extension on your fidelity policy or on your cyber policy. So it is an extension of coverage on both policies, because it sits in sort of this gray area that, you know, if there's a Venn diagram, that's the crime part, is that piece in the middle when it comes to funds being transferred. So it depends on what sort of package, commercial package your company is purchasing from an insurance perspective. But there's a few things to note. One, that conditions precedent language that I mentioned. So if this, then that, or thou shalt do these things. So make sure that you know that you've instituted certain processes within your organization if you have that type of contractual obligation to the insurance company. And then looking at whether or not you actually have the coverage itself. You know, traditional packages, which include an element of 3D of the fidelity coverages, they never extend out to this coverage. So it's something that if you're concerned about it as a business owner, make sure you ask your broker about securing that type of coverage. It's the colloquial term, I have a tough time saying that word, colloquial, is social engineering fraud coverage.
Okay. So everyone listening should check their business insurance. So contact their broker and say, hey, does my policy cover social engineering fraud? And if they say, well, yes, you have cyber coverage, just say, you know what, can I have some clarification on that? Because maybe even the agent doesn't know, and they think that cyber covers them. And I love what you said. It's data and dollars. You know what? Lots of times cyber will cover your data loss and things like that. However, you need to be able to cover the dollars too. Data loss, in my opinion, you need to just have a solid backup solution. Because if you get hit with ransomware, and let's just say you don't have data, you do have a cyber insurance. If you get hit with ransomware, the insurance company assists you with getting your data back, with paying the ransom. But if the data is gone, like, you know, if it's gone, there's no way to get it back. You can't pull it.
It's expensive.
Exactly. And yeah. Then you have time that comes into play. So the best thing to do is to always have a proper backup solution, one that does, like, you know, an image, it's covering the whole network, the configuration, and so on and so forth. So,
and make sure that it's segregated from your traditional networks too, because we see it all too often. We've had to actually pay some ransoms because while the organization did have backups, you know, our business started 4 years ago. And one of the, you know, we rely on applications. So that's how we get our data about Canadian companies. And that's how we make our underwriting decisions. You know, we've changed a little bit because, twice bitten, once bitten, twice shy, right? We ask about backups and about segregation and everything. Now, we had an incident where we had asked, the organization had backups, but the problem was it was just sitting on two separate servers, which were all still part of the same network. So when they got hit by a ransomware demand for X amount of dollars, and these things always happen on the Friday of a long weekend. So, you know, going into Labor Day, my little sister is getting married on Friday of Labor Day weekend. So, I'm crossing my fingers and my toes that I don't, that my cell phone doesn't ring. But at the same time, that's why I have a great team with me as well. But we actually, the threat actors went in and locked up the backups. And at that point, your organization is sort of over the barrel because you really have no choice. You negotiate with them, and you can look at how long it's going to take you to recreate all of the data. But in this particular case, you know, it was deemed to be critical infrastructure. They were doing some monitoring work for some very sensitive types of industry verticals. And as a result, you know, the liability associated with them not being operational for 2 weeks minimum, because that's really what you're looking at, is in a best case scenario, if your business has 10 years of experience, you can't recreate 10 years in 2 weeks. So we looked at it and we said, you know what, we have to negotiate. And it was just as a result of how the business was set up and how the infrastructure was set up. And fortunately, and I say this very truthfully, fortunately, we were dealing, and this is 4 years ago. So fortunately, at that point, you know, there was some honor amongst thieves. Now these ransomware syndicates or ransomware as a service, these gangs or cartels, whichever, however you want to describe them, because there's multiple ways of describing them, they're being run as businesses, complete organized crime. So we actually, when organizations come to us, or when our clients get hit with these things, we're employing forensics, like some of the elite forensics when it comes to Canada. Like these folks are giving.
We're on the list. So yeah.
Yeah, exactly. These, you're looking at the trustworthiness of some of these organized crime syndicates. Like, what is the likelihood that they're going to give me my stuff back? And, you know, we weigh that in. And it's that honor amongst thieves. They don't want negative Yelp reviews. Like that's the reality.
When I do my presentations, I let everybody know that, hey, this is a business. You can go online and you can buy this for X amount of dollars. And they offer a guarantee. You're agreed to, you'll get into this many systems, this many businesses. We'll help you. We have, like, you know, a tech support available for you. And if it doesn't happen, you know what, you'll get your money back. So, yeah, we've seen that before. But I loved it what you said about setting up a network and having a proper backup solution. Because when we do our security assessments and our risk assessments, you know what, I can tell you that 95 to 98% of the times, people think that because they have dual hard drives within their server that they have a backup, or because everything is connected, it goes from here to here, that they have a backup. Yeah. You do need to segregate it. You do need to backup locally and into the cloud just in case, because there are so many variables that come into place. And you do have to have an image-based backup. And you do have to think, okay, how is my business going to continue? Businesses can't be down for 2 weeks and things like that. Like it's absolutely insane.
Test it.
Yes.
Like, you know, even if it's just like testing it once a year is better than not testing it at all. We see it a lot. I mean, for us on the insurance side, one of the big things, and with how ransomware is sort of proliferating now, the big thing is the trend right now is ransomware gangs going in and locking up your stuff, but actually exfiltrating your data, taking the data out. So you've got different organized crime syndicates like Maze. There's a new one out there, DarkSide, which hit one of our major Canadian institutions last week. It was their second hit. you know, there's rumors about who where they started and all of that stuff. I'm not going to get into that. But the fact of the matter is they took down a small part of a $500 billion organization in Canada. So, you know, and they published the data. So when it comes to getting into the backups, you know, it's what we've been asking for years, but the challenge is, you know, it can slow down your business operations, but encrypting your backups too. Now, I think when it comes to encryption, encryption is great. You know, it should be deployed. There's a whole lot of things, but I also understand that, you know, as a business owner, I can't encrypt everything. If I encrypt everything, I'm going to be left decrypting certain things as that I use all the time. But there are ways of layering in encryption. I think it's a matter of businesses taking a good hard look at what they have and what they store on behalf of other people that other people find or could be of value to other people, right? I think
that's what businesses forget, is that it's not all their data that they're storing. It's other people's data. And essentially, when a breach occurs and when these ransomware attacks happen, like, you know what, that's one thing. But now it's other people's data that's out there that essentially, you always hear about the big ones, okay? Like the CRA just had one, Life Labs, Marriott, like, you know, everyone's been breached. Whenever that happens, we're always sending out emails, hey, you know what, change your passwords, you know what, like update like everything everywhere.
Two-factor.
You've got multi-factor authentication happening like crazy. But essentially, you want to protect the data. That's one thing. You want to keep it all private because, you know, big or small, thieves want it all. And the other one that's costing a lot of people money is that when employees accidentally click on the emails, like, you know, yes, they can go through security awareness training, you know, send it to the IT department to have a look. You could put the alerts, this email originated from outside your organization. You know what? Don't click on any links, verify the source. You could have all of these warning messages. But the truth of the matter is it's still not foolproof and it doesn't take very long to click on things. So what we've been seeing a lot of is when I go on site and I meet with people and they're telling me about their computer networks and when we're doing our assessments, this story comes up. That I almost had $40,000 transferred out of my bank account. You know, someone, you know, we almost transferred out like, you know, $2.1 million. And I'm just like, whew. And I was like, good thing you caught it. I was like, so what are you doing to make sure it doesn't happen again? So then, you know, it's easy. You don't remind people about multi-factor authentication, verifying the source, you know, making sure that they're not located, their credentials aren't located in a database, like, you know, on the dark web, things like that. And at the end of the day, you know what we always say, like, you know what, well, what we've been saying now is you have to be insured. Like, you know, is there a way for you to be insured? Because it does happen. And it's painful realizing that you just lost all this money and you did everything it is that you could. It's like a car accident, okay? Like, you know what, they're painful. They happen all the time. You wear your seatbelt. You know, you're a great driver. You know what, but what about someone else on the road who isn't? Like, you know what, how do you stay ahead about that? Well, you want to make sure that you have good insurance. Like, you know what, it's like the whipped cream, the cherry on the top. Like, you know what, yes, it can be a lot of calories, but it tastes delicious and things like that. You want to make sure that you have it. So in general, so doing a security assessment, making sure that you have a good solution, a good backup solution in place and multi-factor, and having all of these processes documented out. Is there anything else that someone needs to have to qualify for a policy? Because I'm thinking of just regular insurance, like even with car insurance. Sometimes you don't want to go through insurance or you think you have the you think you're covered, but you're not, or you are covered, and then you realize that, hey, this is going to like impact me for the long run and things like that. Like, what does someone need to have in place to qualify for social engineering fraud, like insurance, for like Fidelity and certain insurance?
Sure. I think, you know, those three questions, the dual signatures, callback provisions, and multi-factor authentication, those are three of the low-hanging fruit that you can solve on a single call into your bank. I think businesses, it's always a trade-off, right? The time value of money. So, you know, when you're looking at this, it's how long is it going to take me? What is this going to slow me down at all? All of these things have to be considered. At the end of the day, though, you know, you also have to, your business is functioning because you're dealing with money. So as a result, you have to be careful with it. I think from an actual, one thing that we're starting to see the trend a little bit more. If I look back a few years, the applications for this type of coverage, you know, it was a barrier. It was a big barrier because business owners would look at it and be like, well, I don't know how to answer half of these questions. You got to send that to my IT team. And then the IT team would look at it and say, well, I don't know how to answer these banking questions. You got to send that to the CFO. So they're just like in the scenario when you get hit. When you get hit with something, all of those groups are going to be talking to each other. Like, no matter how big or how small your organization is, if you are the sole proprietor and you're wearing a single hat, that's a bit different. But if you have three people and one person does the strategy, one person does the finance, and one person takes care of everything else, you know, all three of you will have to be talking to each other in the event that something were to happen. So the applications are actually, they're a bit, they're not as cumbersome as they were. I will say that. But, you know, really take a look. And I think the brokerage, like the insurance broker community is doing a wonderful job in truly being a risk management partner for their clients. So when you're getting, as a business owner, when you're getting asked these questions, it's a free consulting exercise. You know, do I do this? If I'm answering no to a lot of these questions, maybe we should look a little bit intrinsically at our processes. Maybe we should be looking at, why are we answering no to these things? And why are they asking us about these things? Because if we're looking at how much Canadian businesses are being impacted by these types of losses, it's getting worse. It's not getting better. So I think a chain is only as strong as its weakest link. So if someone's not taking security seriously within the organization, someone's going to get in. And, you know, these questions are being asked for a reason. So I think one of the things, and this is coming from the insurer perspective, one of the things that we should be doing better, and I truly believe this, is communicating with our brokers and with business owners in Canada about why we're asking these questions. Why? What is the impact? And to me, that is the biggest disservice that we can give, is not telling the end public, or the end users of the insurance product, as to why we're asking questions, why things are, you know, if your application is getting longer, the reason being more businesses are getting hit with a new vector of attack patterns. So it's one of those things that, you know, again, everybody hears it. It's not if, it's when, and it's going to get worse before it gets better. So as business owners in Canada, you know, we need to be on our toes. We need to be thinking about these types of things, because otherwise that money is going to go outside of our borders. It's going to go outside of the organization and outside of our borders. And it's very easy and faceless.
You're right. And the only record of that money going outside is going to be on the painful view on the P&L statement at the end of the year.
That's it.
nasty. It's nasty. And it happens a lot. It's funny because when I started offering 10-minute discovery calls, like, you know, call me, ask me questions. And I know that sometimes they call, they're going through the application. Like, you know, hey, you know what? I heard call you and ask you anything because it says at the bottom of my signature, I have the Calendly link. And I'm going through and they're asking the questions like okay, I know where this is going. Essentially, we always end up doing a security risk assessment to go through everything to make sure everyone is covered, that they have proper backups in place. Because all it does is it helps them because you're not going to get insured if you have it's kind of like life insurance. You can't buy a policy and then commit suicide the next day.
Exactly. And you can't insure a burning house, right? For fire.
That's exactly it. That's an excellent description. You can't insure a burning house. And I love the data for dollars. So I have one last question. And I know that you've been around insurance for a long time and you've been in this industry for a long time. So the first thing that comes into your head, what is the most important thing, Greg, that you've ever learned?
In relation to my business or?
Anything. First thing that comes into your head.
First thing that comes into my head is the golden rule. Oh, that is, yeah, the golden rule. I mean, I think we're very fortunate to be in a country like Canada and to be given the opportunity. Apart from the tax that we pay, but we are very fortunate. We're very friendly. And I think Canadians are very trusting and just all around fantastic people. So I think, you know, we do take things for granted a little bit. And the same goes with our security. We take for granted what other organizations are doing on our behalf. I mean, we started this conversation off with banking and about $90 a month fee. It's one of those things. There are realities behind security, and there's a lot of folks that aren't as trustworthy out there. So, CYA, CYA, it's one of those things, but yeah, we're fortunate that we're a very intelligent, very, dynamic country. And our business community reflects that. The most important thing I've learned, I'm still learning that every day, and it's fantastic. And I hope I never stop.
Oh, that's really good. And you know, you're right to implement. We've started the conversation about $90 a month for banking, to make sure that you have two-factor authentication on your bank accounts. Like that's, if you're not going to do anything, that's the one thing that you should do. And at the end of the day, it's going to save you a lot more than $90 a month. Like it's not that expensive in the big scheme of things. And if it's the one thing that you can do, there are small things that you can do. Like the phone call is nothing. The policies in place or the procedures in play, nothing. You know what? The bank account, the two-factor, $90, it's really not a big thing, but multi-factor authentication needs to be employed. Yes, there are a lot of other things that people can do. And
you put it on your email too, because the criminals are, they're very creative, but put it on your email, because put that two-factor on your email, because if they can get into your email, then they can start manipulating anyone else within your organization they can sit there and look at it. So make it tougher for them to get into email, because the business email compromise is the number one route towards social engineering fraud. And right now, as we're working from home, as we're working remotely, we've seen a major spike ransomware incidents have gone down. Business email compromise has gone way up. So make sure you protect your email. Make sure it, you know, you're sending things internally, externally. Just
make sure your email password isn't the same as your banking password. Yeah.
If it's password 123, honest to God, it is. We see that way too much. The number one password in the world right now is still 12345.
Oh.
You need to be better. Period. Yeah.
Wordy at the end of it with an exclamation mark. That's not going to work.
Exactly.
But thank you very much for sharing all your insights with us. It's great that our listeners can hear the same old with a different voice. That's always nice and reassuring that it's out there. And you know what? If any of our listeners have any questions about their IT or vulnerabilities, you know what? Call us 905-542-9759. Today's broadcast has been brought to you by cdntechnologies.com. And cdntechnologies.com is your outsourced IT company providing IT service, IT support, and cybersecurity to small, medium businesses all throughout North America from our worldwide headquarters located here in Oakville, Ontario, Canada. And cdntechnologies.com has been doing IT since 1989. Technology and threats change daily, so shift the stress of managing your tech to cdntechnologies.com. They're direct to tech 24/7, 365, and the mission is to bring you user-friendly, hands-free technology peace. Once again, the number is 905-542-9759, and you can always email me direct at barbarap.tv.